Why is an X-ray called an X-ray? Well, the short answer is when Wilhelm Röntgen discovered X-rays in 1895, he called them X-rays outright because X stood for unknown and he knew he'd found a new, previously unknown ray. Okay, bye. Oh wait, I still haven't answered the question. Why did Röntgen know he had a new kind of ray? And why did the name stick outside of Germany? And why do they use a completely different name for X-rays in Germany? Well, I'll tell you. Ready? Let's go. I would like to start in the 1880s when an English chemist named William Crookes sent some of his photographic plates back for a refund as he said they were defective. What Crookes didn't realize was that the plates were fine. He had actually developed the film himself with X-rays. See, Crookes had been studying something called cathode rays, and it proved that they could melt a piece of platinum if the rays were focused on the metal. What Crookes didn't realize until many years later, however, was that when the cathode rays hit the platinum, it produces X-rays, which can develop film even if the film is protected. As Crookes was focused on the platinum and not on the photographic plates, he just got his refund and moved on. Fast forward to 1892, when a 35-year-old Heinrich Hertz, already famous for discovering radio waves 4 years before, decided to recreate Crookes' experiment of melting metals with cathode rays. Hertz didn't know about the photographic plates. So Hertz was wondering if an unfocused cathode ray could melt an even thinner piece of metal. So he put a super thin gold leaf on the back of a tube. To his shock, the cathode rays seemed to just go straight through the gold to make the glass behind it glow. Hertz then found the cathode rays could make it through all metal as long as it was thin enough. Now, he liked to do all his experiments himself, but he was starting to get a lot of headaches. So he suggested that his assistant, Philip Leonard, should experiment on this phenomena. Leonard then tried something radical. See, cathode rays can only be made inside a very strong vacuum. But Leonard wondered if he could use aluminum as sort of a window to move the cathode rays from the vacuum tube into the air. So Leonard then took a cathode ray tube, put a small hole in it, covered the hole with aluminum foil. Leonard knew that cathode rays, like UV rays, are invisible to the naked eye, but can make fluorescence glow. When he turned on the tube, the fluorescence glowed outside the tube. Even more startlingly, the fluorescence continued to glow a few inches away from his window. This experiment, like Crookes' experiment, produced X-rays. And unlike Crookes' experiment, Leonard was covering his tube and examining it with fluorescence outside the tube. However, Leonard was using fluorescence that were made of light elements with low atomic numbers that were transparent to X-rays, so he just missed out on discovering the X-ray. Tragically, just as Leonard was publishing his results, Leonard's advisor, Heinrich Hertz, died on January 1st, 1894, at the age of 36 from blood poisoning. Leonard basically stopped all of his research to focus on editing a collection of Hertz's work, and then it took him 2 years to find a stable position at a university to continue his research, which is almost exactly when he learned that 50-year-old Wilhelm Röntgen had used his Leonard tube with a different fluorescent to discover the X-ray. Now, Wilhelm Röntgen had been interested in Hertz's and Leonard's work for many years and had actually started studying it in 1894. Röntgen even wrote to Leonard for some advice on how to build his tube with the window. However, Röntgen only had time to seriously study cathode rays by October of 1895. Within a few weeks of study, on November 8th, 1895, Röntgen was working late when he noticed that a fluorescent paper on the side of a covered tube started to glow when the tube was turned on. The fact that the fluorescent glowed on the side of the tube completely floored Röntgen, as he explained in his one and only magazine interview given in April of 1896. He said he was shocked because, quote, "the shield which covered the sides of the tube was impervious to any light known." Röntgen then found that the glowing on his fluorescent was far brighter on the other side of the aluminum window, where it was clearly emanating. Röntgen then started holding up everything he could find in his laboratory between the tube producing the x-rays and the screen glowing from the x-ray. A book, a deck of cards, tinfoil, pine wood, aluminum, rubber, glass. He even tried a glass of water. While Röntgen was basically throwing everything he could find between the tube and the screen, he picked up a small lead disc, and this lead disc was going to change everything. For as he waited for the image of a shadow of the disc to appear on the screen, he also saw something beyond belief, the shadows from the bones in his own hand. No wonder he told his wife that he was working on something that would probably make people say, "Röntgen has surely gone crazy." Röntgen was instantly convinced that he was dealing with a new kind of light that was more powerful than anything he had ever seen. He recalled in that magazine interview, quote, "It seemed at first a new kind of invisible light. It was clearly something new, something unrecorded." As this was a new kind of light, and he already thought cathode rays were another kind of light, he decided to name this new kind of ray an X-ray for brevity's sake, and to distinguish them from other rays, X being the mark of unknown in algebra. Röntgen knew his results were fantastical and was worried that no one would believe him, but luckily he was an amateur photographer and found to his relief that X-rays could develop film while they were still in their protective coating, just like Crookes had found. It was for that reason, on December 22, 1895, that Röntgen asked his wife, Bertha, if she would come to the laboratory and hold her hand on a photographic plate for 15 minutes. They then created a ghostly photo that showed the bones in her hand and the large metal ring on her finger. When Bertha saw this photograph, the first photograph of bones and an intact hand, she supposedly exclaimed, "I have seen my own death." Röntgen published on December 28, 1895, and within weeks, according to Röntgen, all hell broke loose. Almost everyone wanted to play with X-rays, including most scientists, and soon there were traveling X-ray exhibitions, poetry, art, and prudish controversies about seeing through clothes into your bones. My favorite story about that was when a man was traveling around the country doing X-rays. A young woman came to him and asked him if he could secretly do an X-ray on her fiancé to make sure everything was working properly. Lady, that's not how X-rays work. Röntgen wanted nothing to do with fame or controversy, and had to be convinced to give even one public talk by the Kaiser himself, which he did on January 23rd to a packed house. After Röntgen took another X-ray of an attendee's hand, the room erupted in cheers, and everyone decided to rename X-rays Röntgen rays, which they are called in Germany to this very day. At first, in America, in England, in France, and elsewhere, people use both X-rays and Röntgen rays interchangeably. Like this terrible poem titled Exactly So, which mentions both X-rays ways and these naughty, naughty Röntgen rays. However, as modern purveyors of adult films know all too well, the X is very attractive for advertisers. It is used as X marks the spot, so it's comforting to people, as well as being almost never used as the first letter of a sentence, so it's unusual and attracts the eye. Therefore, advertisers selling X-ray sunglasses and X-ray proof underwear and X-ray stove polish, which was a thing, vastly preferred the term X-ray to a foreign sounding Röntgen rays. And within a few years, the term X-ray was the universal name outside of Germany. As you can see from this fabulous silent film called The X-ray Fiend from 1897, where they never mention Röntgen once. Wasn't that fabulous? In Germany, of course, the name Röntgen wasn't foreign, and using it was a way of having German pride in its discovery. And that's how X-rays got their name outside of Germany, and der Röntgenstrahl, got its name inside Germany. But X-rays did more than just shock Victorians by seeing through your skin to your bones. It also caused a rash of new discoveries, including the discovery of radioactive materials. How radioactive materials got their name is next time on The Lightning Tamers. Thanks for watching my video. If you want more information about the physics of X-rays or cathode rays or what have you, I have a lot more videos. Go check them out. Also, big thank you for my patrons. Thank you for supporting me. If you want to be thanked too, there's a link down below. As usual, stay safe out there. See you later.